would like to turn to Frédéric Cazier. We also have the chance to have a member of the Belgian Red Cross here on board and on this MOOC. So, and I would like to ask you a question which is quite similar to the question that I asked to Stefan Karnowski about the task, the function performed by the Belgian Red Cross, but also more generally about the Red Crosses in general. What are the activities conducted by the Red Crosses, and what are the relations, specifically in relation to IHL, and what are the relations between those Red Crosses and the RCRC? You just saw the we've listened about the functions. So,
well, thank you for your question, also for this initiative. First, I would say that there is a specific role that is provided for the national societies of the Red Cross, Red Crescent, according to the statutes of the international movement of the Red Cross, Red Crescent. This specific role is the auxiliary role of the national societies towards the public authorities in the humanitarian fields. That means that the national societies have a specific mandate in order to assist state authorities about humanitarian tasks according to the principles of the movement as independence, neutrality, and also, of course, impartiality. These specific rules include the IHL issues, and more specifically, IHL dissemination and IHL implementation. And if you look through the statutes of the Red Cross, Red Crescent movement, there is this specific task also for the national societies to assist their authorities in disseminating IHL, but also in assisting them to ensure a better respect for IHL. So if you take into consideration these provisions provided by the statutes, you can consider there are two main activities, IHL dissemination and IHL implementation. First of all, it's important to mention that these activities remain first within the responsibilities of the states. It is an obligation for the states party to the Geneva Conventions and to the additional protocol to disseminate IHL, and also to ensure that all the measures are taken already in peacetime to better prepare the states, but also the civilian population in the case of an outbreak of an armed conflict. So the role of the national societies is to assist, but not to substitute the states. However, according to the, I would say, the expertise in IHL that has the National Society of the Red Cross, Red Crescent, we are involved in this kind of implementation of IHL. And implementation of IHL is crucial because it consists in taking all the necessary measures to ensure a better respect of IHL in case of an armed conflict. So it could include national legislation as sanctions for serious violation of IHL according to national legislation. It could also include, I would say, administrative or practical measures as identifying or marking properties that should be protected in situation of armed conflict, as medical care facilities or cultural properties. And it all could also include, of course, IHL dissemination. So, if I may, I would like to just to give some more explanation about these two kind of activities, IHL dissemination first and then IHL implementation.
Of course.
Thank you. For the IHL dissemination, it's important to have in mind that this obligation is the corollary to wider commitments of the states that consist to ensure respect and also ensure better respect of IHL in other countries. It is important to have a knowledge of the IHL in order to better respect the rules. And IHL dissemination means that we should spread the knowledge of IHL among the different target audiences, of course the armed forces, but also other target audiences as the civilian population. But it's not only, I would say, spreading knowledge of IHL. It also consists in developing activities that could ensure that the behaviors of the armed forces, but also other people, will be in compliance with international humanitarian law. So the idea is also to make sure that IHL is included in military doctrines, in instructions for the military from the armed forces. It's important also to make sure that IHL could also be included in the educational programs for the civilians, so that it could also be prepared to face an eventual armed conflict.
And here you relate to the, because you analyze in the MOOC, the obligation to respect and ensure respect for IHL. It's linked to that obligation provided in the Common Article 124 Geneva Convention, I guess.
Exactly. As you said, it's a fundamental obligation provided by the 4th Geneva Convention, Article 1, and also in the first additional protocol, Article 1. I could say also that it's also recognized as such by the customary law. And as you said, it's important and is also linked to this obligation to disseminate IHL. Therefore, you can see that we can reach many target audiences, and there are many target groups that we can reach in IHL dissemination activities. The armed forces, of course, but also the, I would say, the policy makers, as the parliamentarians, the members of the ministries, of the different departments, also the members of the ministerial cabinets.
So do you concretely disseminate and teach IHL to members of the parliament?
Yeah, well, we have some general activities addressed to general public and could include parliamentarians, but we also try at the Belgian Red Cross to organize regularly each year, or regularly, I would say, the session of information about IHL. And it is an opportunity for us to explain what is IHL, what is our role at the Red Cross concerning IHL, and what is the responsibility of the Parliament in order to ensure a better respect of IHL through the adoption of national legislative measures, for instance. So we have also these specific target audiences. We have also other target audiences as the journalists, also young people and actors of education, judicial actors, for obvious reasons that judicial actors can be involved to the sanction of a serious violation of IHL. And we have also the general public, because it's important also to reach every citizen about the knowledge of IHL.
So maybe this MOOC is a means of disseminating IHL to the whole population of many states.
Exactly, yeah. Actually, it is a way to I would say, to spread this knowledge of IHL to every people, including students also from universities. And as you can see, there are different formats of IHL dissemination activities. We can think about MOOC, we can think about e-learning, we can think about specific courses in universities, and also some seminars or conferences. And I should say also, to take another example, there are also some specific role plays that we can also imagine for specific target audiences. For instance, at the Belgian Red Cross, we participate each year in an exercise on the field with the armed forces. And it consists within a role play, when we play, of course, the role of the Red Cross, but also we try also to disseminate some basic rules of IHL to the armed forces. And also it's an opportunity for us to explain the work that the Red Cross does on the field. So it's an opportunity for us also to explain the way of working of the Red Cross, and also the importance to make the distinction between the different mandates, the humanitarian mandate of the Red Cross on one side and the military mandate on the other side. And so for us, it's also another way also to disseminate IHL. Now, this is, I would say, more about IHL dissemination. What about IHL implementation? Implementation means every kind of measure, as I said, that ensure a better respect of IHL as a national law, legislative or regulatory measures, but also other practical measures. We are usually acting through bilateral meeting with different departments of our authorities to discuss about main issues of IHL. So, for instance, Ministry of Defense, Ministry of Justice, but also Ministry of Foreign Affairs. because there could be also some international meetings that will discuss IHL issues. For instance, we have just talked about the IHL compliance process led by the Switzerland and the ICRC. But we have also another approach which consists in discussing about IHL issues within what we called the National Committee of IHL. These bodies are quite important because first, they are not provided as such by the Geneva Conventions and neither by the additional protocol. However, on the initiative of the Red Cross, there has been a decision that has been taken in 1995 at the International Conference of the Red Cross, which invites the states and the national societies to establish these national committees of IHL. Why? Because there are so many measures of IHL to be implemented, and there is a need of coordination between the different authorities, that there is a need also to establish a body that could coordinate these different measures of implementation. And that's why we have in many countries, about more than 100 countries, we have this kind of national IHL committees. And I should say that Belgium was the first one to have a national national committee that was actually established in 1987, so before the decision taken by the International Conference. And I said that Belgium is a model for other states to establish such a commission on a national IHL. So I would say that within these bodies, the Red Cross can play a role as an expert in IHL. In some countries, the Red Cross chair this National Committee of IHL. In other countries, the Red Cross work as a secretary of the National IHL Committee. In Belgium, for instance, the National Societies is acting as an expert of the National IHL Committee. And we are, for instance, chairing two working groups, a working group on International Conference of the Red Cross, which consists in preparing states, authority of Belgium, to the International Conference, but also to ensure the follow-up of the decision taken at the International Conference of the Red Cross. And there is a second working group that we are also chairing, which is the working group on IHL dissemination, in order to see how we could better disseminate IHL to other specific target audiences, as for instance, actors of education, but also journalists, also the economic sectors, or also the healthcare personnel in Belgium. So these are the main roles that could play also the Red Cross within this national IHL committees. In general, these national IHL committees are established according to a national legislation or a royal decree or any other acts provided by the executive bodies or legislative bodies. And it's a real work of advising the governments about IHL issues, about implementation, but also development and dissemination of IHL. So this is for the, I would say, in general way, the activities of the National Society of the Red Cross in the area of IHL. Now, concerning your question about our relationship with the ICRC, I would say that first, it is important that within the movement, we have a coherent approach towards the states to ensure better respect of IHL. And it's important to ensure this respect at the international level, but also at the national level. The respective role of the ICRC and the national societies are complementary for that purpose. And I would say that the ICRC tries to disseminate, promote better respect of IHL, to develop IHL at the international level. And the national societies are trying to support the ICRC work at the national level. Because, as I already said, the national societies have these specific roles, auxiliary role to the public authorities in the humanitarian field. And for that purpose, the national societies have a specific, and I would say a privileged relationship with the national authorities to promote a better respect of IHL. So that's why you can find also in the statutes of the Red Cross movement, the fact that the ICRC and the national societies should maintain a constant dialogue about IHL issues of common concern. So it could cover, of course, dissemination, development, but also implementation of IHL. If I can share some specific examples of cooperation with the ICRC, there are different areas. First, in dissemination, as national societies, we can rely on different material supports provided by the ICRC about dissemination of IHL. We can also rely on the ICRC expertise for specific topics on IHL. And we sometimes also co-organize some specific IHL dissemination activities. For instance, the Belgian Red Cross has the opportunity to organize with the ICRC and also the University of Catholic of Louvain an introductory seminar on IHL addressed to the members of the EU and NATO institution, but also to the Belgian civil servants from the different ministries in Belgium. In the area of implementation, I would say that the national societies can also rely on the expertise on the ICRC and more specifically on what we call the advisory service on IHL of the ICRC. This service actually provides many tools that could be also used by the states and the national societies to ratify treaties and show implementation of treaties. So there are some model, I would say, documents to ratify or also to implement the treaties. And there are also some model documents as model laws in order to ensure a better implementation of IHL at the national level. Now we have also some consultation with the ICRC when we are trying to prepare some international meeting with our national authorities. For instance, as you may know, there are some annual meeting that ensure the follow-up to the treaties relating to weapons, as the Ottawa treaties or the treaty on cluster munitions each year with the states parties. And for us, when we have a meeting with our Ministry of Foreign Affairs, it's always interesting to have, I would say, an exchange with the ICRC to see what are the key messages and what kind of recommendation we can address to our national authorities. Now there is also one last area when we have some coordination and also some exchange is about development and also the strengthening of IHL. We have some regular contacts about some development IHL through the adoption of treaties, for instance. And as you may know, we are discussing now about possible international treaties that could ban nuclear weapons at the UN level. So there are many coordination between the ICRC and the national societies to support this treaty and also to invite all the states to participate in these negotiations. And we can also think about different instruments, non-legal instruments that could also be developed in order to clarify some provisions of IHL. We have also a close coordination with the ICRC in order to prepare the international conference. As you may know, the International Conference of the Red Cross, Red Crescent, contributes to the development and also to the respect of IHL. It is one of the main tasks of the International Conference as provided by the statutes of the movement. And for that purpose, we are working in close cooperation with the ICRC to prepare some resolutions, but also some pledges. And at the last international conference that was held in 2015, we have also the opportunity to work with the ICRC in order to prepare the resolution relating to IHL compliance. And I would say also, last but not least, that we have also some specific networks or reference group when we have a discussion with the ICRC, but also other national societies on specific issues of IHL of common concern. There is, for instance, a reference group on the protection of healthcare personnel in situation of armed conflict. There is also a network about the issue of the nuclear weapons. And there is also now, more recently, a reference group about the IHL compliance issue. And the idea is to, for this last issue, to engage broader process within the movements, including the International Federation of the Red Cross, but also the national societies, to see how we could better support the intergovernmental process on IHN compliance led by the ICRC and Switzerland.
So it's interesting to know a bit about the relation between the RCRC and the National Red Crosses, and how do you consider those National Red Crosses as assisting governments or assisting yourself?
Well, the National Societies of the Red Cross or the Red Crescent have a very specific and interesting and useful status, because at the same time they are independent from their national authorities, from the government, the principle of independence, and at the same time they are the auxiliary of the national authorities. It's very useful, as I said, because they are the perfect link between the authorities and the rest of the movement of the Red Cross and the Red Crescent, and in that sense they have a privileged contact with the national authorities. And as we are working together to improve IHL in the sense of developing, clarifying the law, but also improving compliance with IHL, the specific status of auxiliary is just the best one to address directly the states and have this privileged contact with the national authorities.
So thanks a lot, and thanks, Frédéric Cazier.